Let us stand and worship God. From water to wilderness, God's covenant continues. God's kingdom comes near. On stone and in hearts, God's covenant continues. God's kingdom comes near. From the ancestors of nations to the sun lifted up, God's covenant continues. God's kingdom comes near. We follow Jesus, for where he is, we would be also. The Lord be with you. God of mercy, you are full of tenderness and compassion, slow to anger, rich in mercy, and always ready to forgive. Grant us grace to renounce all evil and to cling to Christ, that in every way we may prove to be your loving children, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
We cannot earn God's grace or favor. It comes to us not as something owed, but as a gift freely given. Confident in God's love for us, even when we are ungodly, we confess our sins in faith. The Lord be with you. God of mercy, you sent Jesus Christ to seek and save the lost. We confess that we have strayed from you and turned aside from your way. We are misled by pride, for we see ourselves pure when we are stained, and great when we are small. We have failed in love, neglected justice, and ignored your truth. Have mercy, O God, and forgive our sin. Return us to paths of righteousness through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. In our baptism, we die with Christ to sin and are raised with him to a life of righteousness. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Since God in Christ has forgiven us, let us also forgive one another. The peace of Christ be with you. You may be seated. Good morning, I'm Katie Gossage, the Associate Director of Youth and Programming. It's wonderful to see you all through either the fog or my lack of glasses. And then also welcome, a warm welcome to those of you at home. A reminder that we still have a few slots to fill for the month of March for Room in the Inn hosts. Spending the night at the location downtown on Tuesday nights. If you have an interest in this or would like more information, please contact a pastor. Also, I'm going to share with you our Minute for Mission. Next Saturday, March 6th, from 9:30 to 12:30 at Shelby Bottoms Greenway, there will be a multi-generational friendly and COVID-safe tree planting opportunity with the Westminster Earth Care Task Force and Nashville Tree Foundation to help repair the damage from the March 2020 tornadoes. These trees will improve the health of the community and work towards a more sustainable community for future generations. Bring gloves and water. They'll provide the supplies and instructions. and look for a sign or someone you know when you arrive there. And you can email Curtis Baysinger to sign up or get more information. His email address is found at the bottom of your bulletin this morning. And that's it. That's all. This way. Please pray with me. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon each of us this morning, that we may see your light, feel the warm glow of hope from your word, and by seeing and feeling, may we understand, and in understanding, may we be moved to creative action. Let us hear what you are saying. Amen. Hear the word of God. From the 17th chapter of the book of Genesis, verses 1 through 7 and 15 and 16. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham. For I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her.
Create in me a clean heart, O God. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Spirit within me.
Gospel of Mark, unlike any of the other Gospels, paints the disciples of Jesus as completely clueless about his identity, Jesus' identity, Jesus, the Son of God. Moments before the text I'm about to read, Jesus has just asked the disciples, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter answered, "You are the Messiah." Peter got the title right, but Peter got the answer wrong. So listen, from Mark chapter 8, verses 21 through 28, hear the word of God. "Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, said this openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, 'Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things.' He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, 'If you want to become my followers, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up the cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospels will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in his glory, the glory of his Father, with the holy angels." Peter seems intent on changing the mind of Jesus. "Don't suffer. Don't be rejected. Don't talk about death. Don't." Peter rebuked Jesus, intent on changing the mind of Jesus. Jesus rebuked Peter, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Setting your mind, being stubborn. This past week, I have had two meetings on two different days with two different couples for premarital counseling. I thought it was odd that both couples said the same thing. Sitting in the same chairs, in the same room, 2 days apart, they said the same thing. "I'm a little stubborn. He's a little stubborn. She's a little stubborn. We're a little stubborn." And under my breath, I prayed that prayer, "Oh Lord, be merciful to this couple." But they were smiling in their stubbornness. They recognized already how silly their stubbornness is at times. They recognized it. And the only way to get out of stubbornness, self-stubbornness, is to be stubborn about looking through the eyes of the other. Allow yourself to see that the trophy over the TV of the Spanish mackerel that you caught 2 years ago on March 5th, one of the happiest days of your life, doesn't go well with the home's new theme. You get married and suddenly Your home has a theme, rustic modern. If the home had an old theme, I suppose it would have been fish on the wall, pizza box on the coffee table. But now, rustic modern. And with new eyes, you'll find that the fish will go much better somewhere else, say, in the basement, on the pile of things that are heading to Goodwill this Saturday. Oh, you can fight about it. You can fight about it. You can set your mind on human things. You can have a knockdown, drag-out fight. She'll sleep in one room. You'll sleep in the other room over a dead fish. Caught on March 5th, 2 years ago. Human things. I'm stubborn. He's stubborn. She's stubborn. We're stubborn. Well, if you're going to be stubborn about divine things. Be stubborn in grace. Be stubborn in mercy. Be stubborn in forgiveness. Be stubborn in that vow. I will love you in joy and in sorrow, in plenty and in want, in sickness and in hell. Peter, Peter, you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Do you know the difference between divine things and human things? A year ago, my phone went off early in the morning. Beth's phone went off early in the morning. Text messages from friends far away. The text messages said, "Are you all right?" Well, why wouldn't we be all right? And then we turned on the TV and realized that Nashville had become the focus of the world. Tornadoes. We had slept through the whole thing. A few days later, I went with a handful of people from the church, oh, not far from here, not far at all. And we surveyed all the human things, just twisted and broken, distorted. And then I climbed up onto a roof, high on a roof, and I had the opportunity to hold on to Dennis Williams' boots from the ridge of a roof while he would be upside down trying to tack in a tarp from a very steep roof. I had that opportunity, but I gave that opportunity to hold on to Dennis Williams' boots to Joe Gaines. I mean, after all, what if my hands slipped? I couldn't very well conduct Dennis's funeral while at the same time be responsible for the funeral in the first place. I mean, friends, we are gathered here today, well, because my hand slipped, and really enough about me. Let's celebrate Dennis now, shall we? Anyway, while Joe was holding on to Dennis's boots, I surveyed the damage from on high. And you could just see a swath where the tornado came through, a swath, wide swath of just broken, twisted brick walls, stone walls, just all over the place. And then I saw people, hundreds and hundreds of people. They looked like ants, just carrying things here and there and to the curb and making piles. And then after a while, they looked less like ants and more like angels. Angels, as if they were loving people that they did not know, in joy and in sorrow, in plenty and in want, in sickness and in hell. You'd hardly know it today, as warm as it is today. But what was it, last week? Oh, did it ever get cold? And the church, we have this ministry for homeless people, homeless. Now there, doesn't that sound like a human thing, a home? Well, this year it's been a hard year in dealing with homeless people. It's just been difficult because what do you do? What do you do? How do you spend the night with people in the same room during this day and age? And yet we move the ministry off the campus And there have been people who've made the food and delivered the food, and hosts who have stayed the night. I don't know how they did it, but they did it. Looking at people that they didn't really know, and saying, I will love you in joy and in sorrow, in plenty and in want, in sickness and in health, until death do us part. Death do us part. Death, death, says Jesus, is a divine thing. Isn't that interesting? If I had two categories, divine things and human things, I would put life into the divine thing and death into the human thing. Because after all, humans die, right? You know that. We die. I hope that doesn't come as a shock to you, that we die. Maybe it does. We've become so good at hiding death in our culture. Even the TV news during the war. Oh, it's all about the bomb, the guided missile, the shock and awe. But when you show the bodies, well, you don't show the bodies. You don't show the mother and the child. You don't show the bodies because everyone knows the news business is a business. And we got to keep viewers. We got to keep the advertising dollars coming in. When they put the flag-draped coffins in the belly of that big airplane, they said, no, no, we can't take pictures of that. That's the way it is. The point is, we hide death very well, even during a pandemic. The ICUs, well, that was a joke, wasn't it? Fake news? Fake news. Don't believe that until someone very close to you about your age, in good health, dies. That's what humans do. We die. I hope that doesn't come as a shock to you. Maybe it does. I was surprised early on in my ministry when a young woman came into my office. And her mother had died, and she came into the office, and she said to me, I didn't know I was going to die. I was young in ministry. I don't know what I said to her. I just listened, I suppose. But it came to her head that suddenly that she was going to die. And I don't know what I told her. I don't think I told her the right thing. Because what she ended up doing was leaving her husband and leaving her kids and starting over again with life. Just left. Jesus says, I'm going to die. How can Jesus say that? Death is giving up. Death is losing. Death, no. You're not supposed to lose. You're supposed to win. It is the human condition to win at all cost. To win at all costs, the hardest thing I think to do is to lose. To give the concession speech in that room that was supposed to have the party, and the loser gets up to the microphone and says, I just called Anna to congratulate her on the win. No, 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 we'll have none of that. No booing. I wished her success. No. No, no, none of that. You mustn't say that. She won fair and square. It's over. And it's time for us to come together now. We fought a good campaign, but we lost. We lost. And what we carry with us is memories, just wonderful memories, wonderful memories. Those memories will hold on. Well, this isn't such a wonderful or happy memory, but we'll have memories. But Anna won. And I'll be taking the Spanish mackerel off the wall now. Rustic, modern prevails, and I will do everything that I can do to help the new administration to lose. To lose. To die to yourself. Jesus says it's a divine thing. Paul says it this way. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but rather he emptied himself. Do you hear the loss? He took the form of a slave. Do you hear the loss? Being born in human likeness and being found in human form, he humbled himself. Do you hear the lost? And became obedient to the point of death. Do you hear the loss? Even death on a cross. Death is a human thing. Death is a divine thing. If you're going to follow Jesus, you have to take up a cross. I know that sounds depressing. It sounds so depressing. I remember the Good Friday service years ago now, the seven last words of Jesus Christ. We all got into the sanctuary towards dusk. And during that service, the seven last words of Christ are sung. And after each time an anthem was sung, the lights would gradually get darker and darker and darker, and then the candles would extinguish one by one by one by one until the passage where Jesus breathes his last and says, "It is finished," and the last candle is extinguished, and the room is dark, and the choir and the narthex singing, "Were you there when they crucified my Lord?" And then we just sat in silence in a dark room like a tomb and left in silence. We were supposed to leave in silence, except one of my members got me in the parking lot, turned to me and said, "That's the most depressing service I've ever been to." And I wanted to turn to him and say, "Well, duh." But I'm ordained, and I know not to do that kind of thing. But even in the church, we don't think of death as a divine thing. The two biggest days of the church year, Christmas and Easter. Give me happy Jesus, happy, happy Jesus. But even that one who turned to me in the parking lot and said, "That service was the most depressing service," that one, well, his wife contracted a debilitating disease. And now he cares for her in joy and in sorrow, in plenty and in want, in sickness and in health. And I think he knows about having a Savior who comes with wounds, who knows the wounds, who knows the pain of death. And I suppose in some strange way it helps. It helps. For today, he'll take out a napkin and brush the crumbs off her face. Today, you'll have to pick her up from the chair and move her to a chair. Today,
give her a kiss and receive nothing in return. All that pain, all that loss, all that love, the love, is a divine thing. Peter was trying to keep Jesus from doing the beautiful. Peter was trying to keep Jesus from dying. But what that amounts to is keeping Jesus from living, keeping you and me from living. It's a beautiful thing to set your mind on the cross, to follow Jesus, to do the divine thing.
Let us stand and affirm what we believe together. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to eternal life. You may be seated. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Heavenly Lord, our thoughts of you are often too small and too few, maybe too rushed and insincere. You know, God. You know us inside and out. You know the messy parts, the growing parts, the wondrous parts. You made us and called us good. You delivered your Son into our hands to show us love unbounded, to show us that death is not the end. We are humbled. God, tune our hearts to sing your praises with every action, every word, every breath. Help us be a joy spreader, or a peace bringer, or a truth bearer this week. Grant us strength to face down our fears, knowing that you are with us and within us. Attend to those in crisis, Lord, however they define crisis. May they be met by your presence and your peace. And finally, God, stir a longing in each of us to turn from our selfishness and to see your justice prevail. Amen. After that congregational meeting, I am feeling fired up about this congregation and in awe of everything that has been accomplished and that God has done through this community. So at this time, let's continue that glory to God through our offering. You can pay. You can make a payment in the Church Life app or on the website. And for those of you here in person, there's an offering plate in the back when you leave. Glory be to God.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God of compassion, we praise you that you look upon our frail lives with love and understanding, and that you desire for us all new life in Jesus Christ. We are overwhelmed by your love, which goes to the cross for us, endures the grave, and leads us to new life. By your Spirit, strengthen our souls to be brave and bold in Christ's service. Take our offerings and use them and us for your purposes. In the name of Jesus Christ, our crucified and risen Lord, amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord be kind and generous to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.